And now you can hear me differently?
No?
Okay. Now?
Yeah.
Okay. All right. Okay, folks. So the plan for today, which is three and final of this series, is we're going to talk a little bit about what we did yesterday. And then I'm going to finish up wrinkles in 2D geometries that we talked about. I'm going to give a quick overview of crumpling. And then I will try and say an example of what you can have when you have the ability to crumple, fold, wrinkle, etc., when a material has all those tools at its disposal. Okay? So last time, we talked quite a bit about 1D folds. I haven't written all the things we said about 1D folds because I'm not going to continue with that today. All right? But as I pointed out, there is considerable progress, but considerable puzzles also here in this business. Okay, so the second half of yesterday, or day before yesterday, we started talking about 2D wrinkling problems. And here, I'm sorry, I dragged you through a lot of algebra. I hope to take advantage of that algebra today to just give you schematically answers. Okay, but I did want to do that algebra because I personally found a lot of that literature pretty intimidating, and I wanted to give you at least an entry point into how this stuff starts off, okay, so that you can get going yourselves. So the way you set this up is you write the two equations of stress balance, force balance. It's just di sigma ij, and now there are two because there's stress balance in the radial direction and stress balance in the azimuthal direction. Yeah? So you have to balance stress along the radius and this way. And this is often called the hoop direction for, I hope, obvious reasons. Then there is this nasty one, the normal direction. In fact, I can put in general normal forces also here. Normal forces, okay? This is the fourth derivative that that goes with the bending, and this is the tension that goes with this with the curvature that balances the normal forces acting on this object. Okay. Yeah. So there are now three equations to deal with. They look much simpler than their general versions if you think of axisymmetric situations. Okay. Things like sigma r theta, epsilon r theta, go away, as do many theta derivatives. Okay? So we use this general machinery and we set up for a specific problem, a planar problem, in which you have an annulus and you're tugging at the inside edges of the annulus and at the outside edges of the annulus. But you're tugging harder on the inside so that these radii, these circles in here get pulled in, okay? Now, we set up the planar version of this problem. So the planar version of this problem doesn't involve the nasty equation. It doesn't involve the fourth derivative equation, right? It involves just the in-plane equations. And we brought it almost to the point of solution, and I don't know if you had a chance to try solving the planar problem. Okay, yes, maybe? Try, it's not hard. We're down to two first order equations, okay? It's not hard, and you'll gain quite a bit of confidence from having done it. But the point of the solution is that for some values of the parameter t in divided by t out, which controls when you get this compression, you get a compressive stress going around circles on the inside, as we kind of expected intuitively. Okay. If you haven't had a chance to work through this, then I should show you again what the solutions look like. This is the inner edge of the hoop. That's the outer edge of the hoop. This is for a particular value of t in divided by t out. You're pulling on the inside 50% harder than on the outside. So these are the radial stresses. It goes from the inside stress to the outside stress. These are the hoop stresses. They go from the inside to the outside. Crank up to 10 times the force on the inside as on the outside. You find it goes negative, the hoop stress, in some region. OK? I really, really encourage you to work this out. It's not hard, the point we got to, okay? Working out these solutions. Just for the planar problem, no complicated von Kármán equation. All right? But the most important thing, I think, that we came to realize was the following. OK, so we have compression in here. Now we need to know how you're going to buckle under this compression, OK? So this parameter told you how you are confining the material. It's like, you know, delta over delta C in 1D buckling, right? But you need another parameter now that tells you, OK, I've achieved this value of compression. Do I buckle? What kind of buckling do I get? And that, if you pull out the parameters in the von Kármán equation that I'll show you quickly, you get another dimensionless number. And this is important. This controls all the buckling behavior. This includes the bending modulus. This combination looks a lot like the combination you had in delta C, in the actual value of delta C, if you remember. It's buckling divided by the width of the system squared, and here's a characteristic force. Okay. So it's some comparison of how the scale at which you want to buckle times the force that's scaled by the force that you're applying. Okay. So this is actually maybe the most important outcome of last time. And before I go ahead and finish solving this problem, I want to make some more comments about this number. So some comments on bendability. Generally speaking, it's bending modulus times some force divided by square of some size of the system. So the first comment is, unlike, what was delta over delta C in the 1D problem? Thank you. Unlike delta over delta C, this includes or tau it includes the elasticity, right? Those T in over T out has nothing to do with the elasticity of the material. Delta over delta C was just the von Kármán number. It was width divided by thickness squared. Neither of these in an elasticity problem had elasticity in it. That's different here. Okay, you're comparing somehow the buckling rigidity against some external force. Okay. The second thing is the following. I'm going to rewrite this a little bit. I'm going to switch back and forth between this and the other. So W squared T over B. I'm going to write it in a slightly different way. Okay, so I'll skip some factors, but I'm going to remember this thing is this thing is Young's modulus times thickness cubed. Yes. I'm going to break that up a little bit differently. I'm going to say this is Young's modulus times thickness and a thickness squared. I'll put a W squared here, and I'll put. What else am I left with? I'm left with the external force. Okay. And another way, which is equal to, this is T over the stretching modulus. E times T. And this is W over T squared. Okay? This is a different way of writing the same thing. And I want you to recognize there is something kind of interesting here. This is tension divided by stretching modulus. Right? It tells you something about how much you've strained the material. Right? So this is like strain. This is strain. Okay? This guy is a von Kármán number. Right? It's just geometric. Is okay? Now, what I want you to see is typically in elasticity problems, the strain is a small number, right? In linear elasticity, could be a big number, but typically it's very, very small for this piece of paper. Strains are going to be tiny, right? You don't stretch the material a whole lot. So usually this is small. I'm sorry, I'm going to raise this a bit and obscure. This is a small number usually. For thin things, this is a large number. Yes? W is sort of the characteristic size of the system. Thank you. Some length. I just wrote W because I didn't want it to be specifically about all about this problem. But you know, I think W is a symbol I'd use for the width of various things previously. So I just wanted to put that in. So you have a small number times a large number controlling your physics. It could be anything. It could be small, large, or order one. Okay? So this number, you can be working on a problem in thin sheet mechanics and have it be extremely large or extremely small. Okay? So in life, you should please look at your experiment or whatever you're thinking about and try and compute this number and decide where you are. Okay, before you run with a calculation or some understanding of your experiment. There's a third thing I wanted to say. Yeah, a third thing I think I started saying on the board, but I'll say it again last time. Let me just say it again because I think it's sort of relevant to how we're going to deal with this. So this is small multiplied by large equals anything. Okay. So I just wanted to say that small epsilon and large epsilon represent two completely different ways in which you should look at this equation. All right. So if you do this guy minus sigma ij del I del j zeta equal to normal forces, then this term is something like b times zeta divided by some characteristic length power 4. This is something like the forces you apply. That's what this one looks like, and that's what this one looks like. Okay? Bendability is just the ratio of these things. So it's some external force. You see, in this one, there's no real external force, but there could be a substrate in some of the problems we've dealt with. Yeah? So So I do. What did I do wrong? Thank you, Emily. But I think I got it right the first time. Okay. I think that's right. Huh? So bendability is sort of the ratio between these two things. Okay. So what I wanted to say is, you apply some external forces or some boundary conditions or you some constraint to the sheet, and it's going to work out how it's going to balance that. Depending on what epsilon is, either this term is going to do the lifting or this. So these are two different ways in which a sheet can respond. Okay, and you have completely different terms in the equation that do the real effort for you here. Okay, I put an analogy that one of my colleagues who's learned stuff from on this always gives. So this is like hydrodynamics. You have the nasty Navier-Stokes equation. Once you identify Reynolds number, you realize there's a limit in which you have sort of a linear viscous theory, okay, which is the Stokes regime, in which all the inertial terms fall out. And then you have highly inertial flow, in which you can start thinking about this sometimes as just a dissipationless liquid. Okay? Viscosity controls maybe some scales, but mostly not. Okay? So this sort of Stokes and Euler regime is separated by Reynolds number. Huge Reynolds number, small Reynolds number. In the same way, you can think of the even nastier von Kármán equations having two limits controlled by bendability. Okay? In one limit, where you're very highly bendable, then this term can't do much for you. Okay, your bending rigidity is very small, it's very floppy. These guys have to either work it out amongst themselves. Okay? Or you have to work at low bendability, okay, in which bending is what resists external forces. And now you have a parameter that allows you to go slowly away from this regime and slowly away from this regime. Okay, here you will expand in powers of epsilon. There you will expand in powers of epsilon inverse. Okay, and we saw some hint of this. Okay, remember the very first problem we did was the elastica. Close to the threshold, bending balanced outside forces. Epsilon minus, yeah. I'm sorry, I didn't define epsilon. I would have defined it differently to start off with. Bendability, more bendable means small epsilon. High bendability is small epsilon. But yes. Okay?
It's different from what you wrote on that.
Is it? Highly bendable epsilon inverse. This is right. No, it isn't. Is it? I think it's right. I think it's good. Okay. So these are just words, but I think they're sort of important words for understanding why this is an important new feature. Okay. So with any problem you have, you could be well into one of these regimes and still be in a thin sheet situation. You have to figure out where you are and start thinking accordingly. Okay. Now let's go back to what all these random words mean for the Lamé problem. Okay. How do you deal with the Lamé problem qualitatively when you're here? How do you deal with the Lamé problem qualitatively when you're here? And I'll just tell you the procedure and the answers. Ishan, you're going to say something? Yeah? Ask?
So low bendability means B is small?
Highly bendable means B is small.
Oh,
yes.
Okay.
Bending rigidity is small. But you see, I want to say that, but I also want to say, importantly, it depends on external forces. The same sheet in one situation can be highly bendable and in another situation, not highly bendable. There's a T over there, which is an external force. Okay? So I'm glad you brought up the point about B, but I want to say this is B against something external. Okay, and that wasn't there in our earlier ways of thinking about this. Okay, so now back to old Lame, and I'll tell you how you use these words in calculation, but I won't do the calculation anymore. Okay. All right, Lame. So this thing, near solution, near, so I want to say, so again, I want to remind you, this is very much like what you had very close to buckling and very far from buckling, where we thought of things as inelastica. Do you remember that's how we thought of standard Euler buckling? There, the answers for both limits were not so very different. Okay, all right, so how do we do this? So I'm going to do first near threshold. Okay? So the way you do it is you first solve that problem. And you say, in this region, it's compressive. Here, sigma theta theta is less than 0. And maybe this is your first guess at the length of wrinkles. Okay? And I'm going to call them length near threshold. All right? You just say, I'm going to find where it turns compressive, and I'm going to say, let's say that's our first pass at where things are. Okay? So, near threshold. So, first thing is, solve planar problem, Lame. Okay, I've lost all his letters. Okay, solve the Lame problem, and you get that number. Then, until now, we've not used the bending, the out-of-plane von Kármán equation, right? This is just in-plane. So, plug sigma theta theta and sigma rr into normal equation, the del for psi 1. Okay? Take the solutions you got from the planar stuff, put it in the second term, yeah, put it in the von Kármán equation. Okay? Then, assume small wrinkles. So say that this is some function of r and cosine m of theta. Okay? And plug in. Okay? Now you've got to solve that second von Kármán equation. So solve or balance terms. That's to say bending. You say bending is about balance is stretching. And you can get scalings for all these things. Okay? And the scalings are that the actual value of the critical threshold is, you know, remember we got it at t in over t out equal to 2. It's some function of epsilon now. Okay, this thing actually has some rigidity, which comes in through the bending. Our best guess for the length of the wrinkles is slightly modified. This goes again as some power of the bending. And again, the number of wrinkles is some function of the bending. Okay? I won't go through this algebra, but you can in the papers that I've given you. It's not dreadfully difficult. I'll put it in the notes. Okay. So this is very, very much like we did, like we said for 1D buckling. Sorry, everything is very low, is it? I can't. Is it just the last line? Is it just the last line? Okay, don't worry about the last line. The last line are results for, it's results for which you will not have intuition, but they're results for the length of the wrinkle, they're results for the number of wrinkles you see. Okay? Yeah. It's the bendability. It's whatever it is. Okay? And as discussed, I'll say in a minute what happens when epsilon is big and small. Okay? But it's the bendability. Now, what do I do for when I'm far from threshold? Okay, so far from threshold is the new thing. Now, far from threshold, what I'm going to do is I'm going to say, so FT, lame, sorry, this is which you can't read, far from threshold. Okay. Here's the first thing you do. You say, I don't know what's going to happen in here, but this material is really well beyond buckling threshold. And the wrinkles can wrinkle any way they like. And my version now of an elastica, and I'll tell you in a few minutes why it is not that the lengths in here will be conserved. Remember, that's what the elastica did. It said, I'm going to buckle as much as it takes to keep my length the same as it was when I was unbuckled. I'm going to say something else. I'm going to say the wrinkles do whatever it takes to make sigma theta theta equal to 0. I'll come back to that in a second. Okay? Okay? That's really what you say. When you, in the 1D problem, we didn't say that explicitly, but that's what you're saying. Right? If you keep the length the same, there is really no stress in plane. And in 1D, having no strain in plane and no stress in plane are the same thing. Hooke's law is just F equal to kx. If delta x is 0, F is 0 in 1D. Here it isn't, and I'll say, OK? So this is, I'm generalizing with new spelling the word, the idea of elastica. Yeah.
So in this feature, are we sort of treating the top of the equation as like a perturbative perturbation on the limit
That's right. Exactly.
So that's doing a perturbation.
It's a perturbation on the flat solution. Yeah. I've taken the flat solution and I've said it's basically going to work, and I'm going to put in a small amplitude wrinkle. Okay? And say, now what does the bending need to do to balance that? Right. That's right. F of r will be some, will end up, the amplitude will end up being some function of how far you are away from delta c. Okay? So this is, yes. So exactly. So this is a perturbation in the amplitude. Okay? Now we're going to do a perturbation in something else. Now we're going to say this part is flat, right? There's no wrinkles here. Here we can continue to use the old Lame solution, right? There's nothing much going on outside the wrinkle region, okay? So here's what you do. Now you do it in two steps. There you got the stresses, and then you threw length and wavelength into bending. Okay, now I'm going to do this in two steps. I'm going to first say I'm going to get length by minimizing an energy of radial stretching inside plus radial and azimuthal stretch outside. Sorry, I mean this as being out and in. Okay? So outside, there is both in stresses in both directions, and I have to include those. Inside, I've decided to start by this saying I can bend at any wavelength you like. I'm going to start with bending equal to zero. I'm going to start as if epsilon is that bending comes for free. Okay? So now there's no bending in this. I need to minimize this, and the parameter I need to use to minimize is this length, this unknown length. I don't know where the wrinkles extend to. Okay? And this gets the length in far from threshold. Second step is I get the number of wrinkles. The number of wrinkles will be involve bending, but that's going to be a much smaller energy. I have to let all the stretching sort itself out, and now I'm going to put in wrinkles, and that's a small correction. Okay? Wavelength from smaller energies. These are big energies out here. This is the main thing in the problem. And this involves various pieces inside. So the energy has bending in the theta direction, azimuthal bend inside. And now there'll be a little bit of azimuthal compression inside. I've decided to put in wrinkles. Bending, azimuthal compression inside, plus a little bit of stretching inside, new radial stretching, a little bit more radial stretching. If I have to make wrinkles in here, I have to lift the piece up, right? Radial stretch due to wrinkles. All of these involve epsilon, and they're all in here, okay? And these are all really small. These are all small pieces compared to the big piece. That was not the case here. I solve the radial problem, then if I want to get wavelength, I have to balance bending against all the in-plane forces. Okay? And I guess I want to tell you that the answers are completely different for this procedure and the other procedure. Yeah. Okay, here, yeah. So here, this is the limit that we work around. First, we start by assuming that bending is just free, takes nothing to bend, and you'll organize as many wrinkles as you need here to completely relax the compression. Okay, then you solve the problem with no bending in it. Then you say, okay, now actually bending doesn't come absolutely free. So this is the perturbation that I put in epsilon. Now bendability is very high. So now I perturb with epsilon. There I perturb with amplitude.
So in your first step, you allow principles just as a geometric way of eliminating sigma theta theta.
That's right.
You just say, give me as many as I need to make sigma theta theta zero.
Okay, you're saying it better than I did. Good.
And then you say, what did I get from that? And then you perturb the energy cost.
Now I perturb the energy cost in epsilon. I say a little bit of energy for bending. Yeah. We don't know what we don't know the length of the wrinkles.
We want to perturb about the fully wrinkled state.
That's right. That's right.
And in which case we don't know LFT.
That's right.
That's the first calculation.
That's right. That's right. And this gives you wholly different answers. And I just now I just go back to yeah.
So you don't actually model if you want to do 3D problems.
So this is my version of how they're coming out of plane. Okay? In the beginning, I say, I'm just going to let as many wrinkles proliferate here as are necessary to adjust for the right length. Yes, yes. And then I put those back. I put those back, but with very small energy. Okay? They cost almost nothing. They don't balance stretching. They don't balance the important parts of the stretching. Okay? So now I just want to show you how different the answers are. I showed you this pair of pictures. If I think about this in the Pfaffron threshold way, I say, OK, I don't know what this region is, but I'm going to say the hoop stress here is 0. And now I must solve the Lemay problem for the remaining pieces. Yeah? I can. We're always minimizing, and now he starts maximizing. There's yes? Okay. Yes, maximized. Thank you. Thanks. So you get a completely different answer. So here the variable that you're minimizing over is the value of this place. Okay? And I just want to show you the consequences for this problem. This is one of the wrinkling problems I showed you amongst many, and it's, I think, where we did the best test. So here again, you're putting a thin disk on top of a drop of water, and you're slowly changing the curvature of the water, of the meniscus from flat to something. Okay? And as you do that, like in a map, like in mapping a globe onto an atlas, you have to do something at the outer perimeters, and you get more and more compression as you curve this thing more and more. Okay? So there is some confinement which in detail is different from that confinement. But the confinement parameter tells you that geometric issue. Okay, so as you curve more and more, this is side view, top view, you start seeing wrinkles invading. Initially, you get something smooth, then you get wrinkles coming in, then the wrinkles go in further as you curve more, and so on. Okay, and the obvious questions are how long are these and how many are there? If I do this perturbatively, I'm going to show you now data. This is written in a funny way. This is the length of the unwrinkled part as a function of this whole radius. So one means no wrinkles. Okay? So the Pfaffron threshold, the near threshold calculation, that's to say this correctly predicts when you start getting wrinkles, at what value of confinement, but it's way off on its prediction for the length of the wrinkle. Okay? So this is sort of the post-buckling or the near threshold or the Landau expansion or the amplitude expansion or whatever you want to call it, okay? So it gets the wrinkle length basically entirely wrong, though it gets the threshold perfectly correct, okay? So there'll be some region in which you might argue with me, it looks pretty good there. So I won't argue with you. It does look pretty good there. Now I do the Pfaffron threshold calculation. And I'm bang on, okay? Or sort of bang on. There are some interesting deviations here. These contain physical information, okay? So now the question is, how did I know which calculation to use, right? And the answer is, you must measure epsilon for your material and decide where you are in this phase space. So for this particular problem, if you plot confinement against bendability, you get something that looks like this, okay? Initially, you start off with a smooth state. You follow that calculation to find where you start getting wrinkles. Above that, as you go above that, you can expand in amplitude, and you get very good agreement with things like this in your threshold. Then it starts getting fuzzy. Okay, you start having to put more and more powers of amplitude. I'll have to start considering terms not in f, but in f squared and blah, blah, blah. Okay? Which you want to do? Confinement means exactly what it means that we've done before. It's how much length you're trying to fit into a place. So it's the confinement that we had in the earlier in the 1D problems was delta divided by the width of the system. Here it was T in over T out. Here it's some other combination of things, but it says the same thing. It's how much length you're trying to squeeze in into an inappropriately small place, okay? And that's the idea. Okay. If you work with thin materials, you find there is actually no regime. The sliver in which the near threshold calculation works almost vanishes. So you go a little bit beyond threshold, and you are no longer get anything of the near threshold solution. Okay, you jump straight into far from threshold. You get into this situation where, in this case, the wrinkles can completely deal with the stresses out here.
How do you calculate the boundary between the near threshold and far threshold?
I don't. I don't really know how to do it. That's to say, the people who do this can tell you systematic expansions going away from here, and systematic expansions from deep in here. Okay, so there is a very fuzzy boundary here, and I'm sorry that I drew this picture. Thanks for asking. But the we haven't got there yet. We'll get to it in a second, I hope. So the main point I want to get is there's almost no regime of near threshold for highly bendable stuff. Practically speaking, if you'd, and I just want to say, we are not dealing with super, super thin stuff. The stuff we're dealing with are tens of nanometers. We're not talking about graphene. This is what you can get with, it's very high von Kármán number, as high as the von Kármán numbers in the graphene problem. But you know, tens of nanometers is nothing in technology, in biology, in nature. It's, you know, it's this, what we made is easy. Okay? Okay. Sorry, you had a question. You had a question about crumples. You'll wait and see. OK, so what I wanted to tell next was about crumples. But maybe this is the time for our 5 minute stop. Yes? I will be very cursory in what I tell about crumples. I want to speed through that. OK, see you in 5 minutes. But I will start in 5 minutes because I'm very greedy for time today. Thanks.
If I blur my eyes, it almost looks like it's broken it in a very ordered way.
It has, and I'll show you that.
It's selected a length scale.
It's done exactly. It's very done a. It's it has.
Beautiful.
I will. Yes. Go ahead.
So in the far from threshold calculation, does the second step change your LFT or the length of the wrinkle?
Not perturbative. In this order of perturbation, it won't. You just keep the same
length. The second step just tells you the number of
Okay. Here, you have to determine them together.
Okay.
Because bending and stretching are both coming together.
Okay. I see. F of R tells you the length of the wrinkles.
F of R? Okay. So in the spirit of the things we've been doing, I will just tell you about a few of the pieces that make up crumples. Okay? And I'll tell you, I think, one issue that's really not worked out. And I'm going to tell you this at high velocity, and so you'll see it shooting by, okay? So the first thing is, if you crumple something like this, this is a really nasty problem, okay? So let's try and pick out a couple of the pieces of the problem that people have thought about successfully. We can measure the hell out of this, and we have, but there are only small bits that you understand. So I'm going to start by showing you maybe the first thing I ever learned about this stuff, which is two simple defects you can get. One is a cone, okay? And then if you have another cone in there, you have a ridge between them, okay? I all encourage you to do this for yourself and look at it more carefully than you've ever done before, because you'll see that this ridge is interesting. It's extremely interesting for the following sense: is it's not a straight ridge. This is not a pure bending ridge. This is not what you would get if you take a piece of paper and do this. All right? And this is what was worked out by these folks. This is Alex Lobskowski, was Tom Witten's extremely clever student. The point they made is the following. You can, if you like, if you look side on at something like this, if you constrain something to some angle, and you put this out here, okay, this is a side view of a ridge. Oh, I made the bad choice of board, right, already? Okay. But that's a side view of a ridge. You can say I can have a purely cylindrical ridge running through, or you can say, well, this thing does know how to stretch. So it could use some of its ability to stretch to relax a bit. Okay? So instead of a, that's not the side view, this is the section. I'm taking a section through the, so the side view, instead of being like so, may end up sagging. Okay, this is a longer line than you started off with. This is stretching, right? But if you have that degree of freedom to trade off against a very sharply bent curve, you'll do it, right? Instead of making this curve like so, and having a vast amount of bending over there, you let this slump a bit, okay? And you get something that stretches in this direction, okay? So they did a very detailed analysis of this, but they also did a cheap scaling analysis. And the cheap scaling analysis already tells you something interesting. So I think given the time, I actually won't do the scaling analysis. I'll just tell you, there's just one parameter in this problem. If you think about this as the radius, it's got to choose a radius. You specify the length at which it's pinned. And if you like, you specify this angle. Okay? Now, it should choose the radius that it likes. And I want to say to you that this radius and this are geometrically determine each other. How much it slumps in the middle is not an independent parameter from what radius it chooses, as you can tell, right? You can solve this geometry problem, and you can get r in delta in terms of r. Okay. So minimize e stretch from this picture, which is a function of r, plus e bend from this picture, which is a function of r, get r, and you get some relationships. It tells you what the energy stored in this structure is. It tells you what this radius is, and things like that. So the typically, if you have two energies to give, the way you, when you minimize this, typically this is going to end up being the same order as that. There's no constraints, right? So the best thing you can do is sort of not have one term be huge and the other term be tiny. Okay? So you end up a situation where the bending energy and the stretching energy in the ridge are approximately equal. Okay? I won't do the scaling. I put it in the notes, so it's very easy to do. Okay? But the crucial observation here is, the nice observation here is the following. Now, if I'm looking at this from above, here's the ridge, okay? And here's where it's curved, okay? You see the picture I'm drawing? It's curved something like over a region R. And this is a length x. If I find the area of deformation, the area in which all the energy is stored, it's something like R times x. And divided by total area, let's say this is an approximately square sheet. And I put in the value of R that I get from this calculation, which is from the calculation I didn't do for you, thickness to the 1/3 x over x squared. This is t over x to the third. So the consequence of this is, as this sheet becomes thinner and thinner, the area over which the deformation lives becomes smaller and smaller and smaller. So this tells you exactly what you see with your eyes. If I take a big fat thing and I crush it, I don't see sharply defined wrinkles. If I take a thinner thing and wrinkle it, in the end, the energy will dwell in a vanishingly small portion of the sheet. Okay? This is completely different from all the localized solutions we've been doing with the wrinkles. It's a little bit like the fold. Right? But the fold stored energy, it was a localized solution, but it stored it all in bending. I just did this. This is a different class of solutions. It localizes, but it stores it in a roughly equal proportion of bending and stretching. Okay? But it puts everything at one point along one line. Similarly, there are calculations for this guy. Oh, I should get to... Is there a way not to have Edurome insist on? So the next thing is the cone, and that cone actually you can think of as most easily as you know, take this and push it into a. If my coffee cup was empty, I'd show you. But basically, this is the way you start the cone. You push it into a hoop, and you get something like this. Okay? This thing is called a D cone. This is what Nelson was asking on day one. D stands for developable. What does developable mean? It means that every straight line in this stays a straight line. It's a cone, basically. Everything that's what they've drawn over here. Okay? So there's no stretching anywhere, except maybe at this very tip. All right? You can figure out the energy of this object. And you know, it's like figuring out the energy, bending energy in a cone. But you have this guy that does this, basically. And every section of it looks like this. Okay? And if you figure out the bending energy over here, again, I won't do this in dreadful detail, but if I have a coordinate that runs along like this, and if I have an angle over here for the cone, then you know how to figure this out, right? You just integrate the bending along any cut like this. And roughly speaking, you're going to get something that is, if you deal with many line defects in objects, you've seen this, you get something that looks like log r. Okay, again, I will put this one line of algebra in the notes. Yeah. Sorry, I meant to call this angle. Okay. Log r is no good. R is the size of this. R is this size, system size. Okay, and it's no good when you get down to here. Right? Down here, you are cut off by by something else. There's some actual action. Please do this to a piece of paper or a piece of plastic, even better. This gentleman here does this for a living. Okay? Please look close to that. It's a very beautiful and interesting crescent singularity. Okay? This doesn't come to a sharp point. There's a scale over there. And it's that scale that cuts this off. There are calculations and predictions for that scale, and that have been tested kind of nicely. And it's in that paper. It depends, yes. So this depends. Good. Again, it's the same thing. If you went to a point, you'd be all bending. You're allowed to stretch. Why not give a bit? Okay, it's the same calculation as the ridge. So you'd relax a bit. And that selects for you the radius of this crescent. The third thing that I'll tell you at even higher speed is the following. This is called the E cone. So here I took a cone and I shoved it into too small a space for it. Now, I'm going to do the opposite thing. I'm going to take a cone. So I took a circle, and I cut out a sector in it, and I put in another sector. Okay, so this is 480 degrees worth of circle. All right? And you can put in any amount you want. And this guy is called excess cone. Okay? And again, there is a lot of the same physics here. Outside, this is developable. There's a lot of bend. Then inside at the core, you start having to wonder what you do with this focus point over here. So this can be achieved in the problems we did at some level. If we didn't have a substrate in the Lemme problem, you could get things that looked like this. I'll pass around one that is tensional. But the place it comes very, very naturally is in growth problems. You start off as a circle, and you start adding perimeter faster than 2 pi r. Okay? The next thing you add is, and then you get all these beautiful ruffles and potato chips, and these look like flowers. And this is one paper in a very beautiful series of papers from Eran Sharon's group. This is the paper which Effie was on. But okay. But you can achieve this by tension also is the issue, and I'll send around one that does it for you by tension. So you can get these things that look like E cones by tension if you want to send it around. Okay. Yeah, that's PDMS with a stiffer piece of PDMS differently cured in the middle. So you can get it tensionally, but the elegant way that flowers do it and which Charon does it is by growth. Somebody else had a hand up. Yes, please, Henry. Okay, so once you get into self-contact, this problem becomes very interesting because the tangent suddenly flips from one direction to another. Okay, none of these are at self-contact, but you see it in plants. You see things that are bunched up. They're actually they're like this. You know? So there, the problem gets quite a bit more complicated. So the thing I want to say is many big things are known about crumples. Some things are known very nicely about cones, and even more exactly about ridges, and about e-cones. Once you start putting more forces on it, things get a bit complicated. So crumpling on top of substrates, crumpling with tension on it. These are free objects, right? No tension, except internally geometrically generated stresses. Okay, and I want to show you an example where you can get crumples smoothly going from wrinkles. You know, I said this is localized, this is delocalized. I want to know how you cross across from one to the other. I showed you this experiment where you start developing ridges, wrinkles on the edge of a drop. I want to push that a little further and show you what you get. So I showed you wrinkles earlier. Now I curve this drop a little bit more and I start seeing some wrinkles win. And I think this is what you were picking up on. If I go further, I eliminate many wrinkles and I start getting very sharp features here, and even sharper features as I keep going. If I zoom in on that, these are very sharp singularities. These are points where you have not resolved the extra length purely by bending. You have to put in localized features, okay? And this should remind you of, you know, scars and disclinations. This should remind you of things that you see with materials that have an underlying lattice. This doesn't have an underlying lattice, but it's doing the same thing. It's finding a different way of hiding material, right? That's what it's doing. If you put a crystal on a curved surface, for example, it has the option of taking out some rows of atoms and patching up. Okay, here it can't completely excise those pieces of material. What it does is it folds it and tucks it away somewhere. Okay, so it's a different mode of doing it than a fold or a wrinkle. It does it in a way that concentrates both bending and stretching. Okay. Here's just another way of doing it. So. Yeah, you push to higher and higher radius of curvature, and then you start seeing these things. Higher curvature, yes. So I'm not imposing curvature. These are all pressure controlled. But you can think of it that way, yeah. So the actual curvature of the free part of this is selected by itself. Okay. So I do want to say, now that we're in territory that we don't understand, I showed you this transition, which now we understand everything about this. I showed you that we know exactly when this transition occurs, and I know how to deal with it in small amplitude, I know how to deal with it in big amplitude, everything, right? That's the thing that we did with the Lemay. The math is slightly different here, but we know an amplitude expansion, and we know the equivalent of the elastica, just as we tune the bending parameters, okay? This transition, we don't understand, okay? And I think there is maybe a couple of good examples in which you can smoothly tune from a wrinkled solution, a delocalized solution, to a localized solution. This is one of them. We can characterize it experimentally really, really well, but we don't understand it nearly at all, okay? Here's another nice example. This is from the lab of Arshad Kudroli. His postdoc, Julien Chopin, did these nice experiments with twisted ribbons under tension. And again, you get smooth solutions that suddenly start kinking. Okay, this piece is understood. Something about this piece is understood. The connection between these two pieces is not so well understood. Okay, and I must say it's very much the same situation in this problem. Okay, we understand the elements on deep in each phase, but that's about it. So if you want to work on these things, please chat with me, and I'll tell you all the clues that are available. There are several experimental things that can be said, but in terms of understanding the wrinkle to crumple transition, I think we're still at a very baby stage. Okay, so I've told you now that there's lots of pieces we have assembled in understanding what wrinkles, crumples, and folds can do. You know, their energetics, their shape, various things like this. But now I want to ask, you know, what do you get from them? And what I want to point out is, if you have these freely available to you as modes of deformation, you can achieve some very, very interesting things. Okay? And I want to show you for the first time a pretty large deformation experiment. Okay? Everything I've said, even those von Kármán equations I wrote for the Lemay problem, I wrote everything in small slope. And I want to show you very large slopes and show you some things that you can see. Okay, so I will now show you an experiment which I found very cute that appeared maybe 7-8 years ago, and maybe Eric will have more to say about things like this. But this is this very cute little experiment from the ESPCI group, who do many very cute experiments. They're the guys who did the bunches of hair that Eric showed. Okay, so here's the idea. They call it capillary origami. That's the only thing I don't like about it is the name. This is not origami in any sense, but it's very cute. So here's the idea. You take a piece of PDMS, and you put a drop of water on it in this case, and you cut it out in various shapes, depending on what shapes you like. Okay? And the water wets the PDMS, and it grabs the edges. Then you wait for the drop of water to evaporate, and it does this, you know, pulls it in. So, I think I had a little movie of this. Yes, exactly. You said the next few words I was going to say, which were, yaar. It's a very nice movie if it would play. Oh, is it? Ah, sorry. I need to get to the bottom of this. Now I've shifted to the other thing that I wanted to show you after. This is terrible. Okay. So this is a slow movie. They're watching it dry over, you know, minutes. And then when it's dried out, it just opens out, okay? So what is happening here is what, who said? Somebody, you said, okay, you said. You said that what they're doing is the bending balances these torques created by the capillary forces at the edge, at these contact lines, okay? And the thing that they do very creatively is they cut flaps nicely in this so that you can get shapes that are just purely bent shapes, okay? They only bend in one direction, all these shapes, okay? And you can do anything you like. Okay, this is a demonstration. People have done more with this technologically. You can seal these, you can cross-link them at the end, you know, whatever you like. But this is the thing, okay? So the question I want to show you, but I do want you to see this is pure bending. The only features you get are at very large scales. This is the Euler buckling of the problem. Okay? Now I want to ask the following question. Suppose you do it with thin stuff. There's hardly any Gaussian curvature in any of these, right? You can tell. You can look at the shapes. No? They all have like smooth corners, smooth cylindrical corners. Yeah? I want to show you what happens when you do Okay, so these are the cast of characters. Joey Paulson is the postdoc who did all these things, and he's tipping his hat to this beautiful work by that I just showed you. So this is the question. Suppose you did much thinner. That's 50 microns. Suppose you do 50 nanometers. And that's the experiment. So let's stop right there. So now I make things that are so thin that, let's say, bending is almost free. What do you think is going to happen as Joey makes this thing really small? And if you've seen this before, climb up. What do you think it's going to do? I mean, the drop of water all by itself wants to be spherical, as you knew, presumably, and as you learned reasons for. So if this is so thin that it doesn't care how much it bends, what do you think it'll do? Right now the sheet is, yeah, but it's, I'm going to shrink the drop, you're going to see the drop of water shrink. What do you think is going to happen? Okay, he's saying spherical shell, it's going to make a nice shell.
No, chocolate.
Like a chocolate.
The chocolate.
Like a ball of chocolate, like what's that thing, the thing with the... Yeah, that thing, the Ferrero thing. That's the Ferrero thing. Okay, so that's a very reasonable guess. I'm going to show you the answer is very different, but you can think that's a very reasonable guess because I can make all those crinkles and crumples that I need to at the bottom of that Ferrero thing, right? The North Pole of Ferrero is smooth. South Pole of Ferrero has all kinds of rubbish there. But that rubbish is free because you can bend so easily. Okay? Okay, so this, you can see it now, right? So you can see already that it doesn't like the chocolate solution. Yeah? So now I'll just show you the top view. See, this is the thing you saw earlier, just the beginning of this process. It has wrinkles that have become crumples. There's a whole bunch of crumples. As many crumples as you want because it's so thin. As we said, the problem here is mainly radial stretching. All the energies are stored in radial. This is very high bendability. These things come at order epsilon, where epsilon is bendability. These things don't cost much energy. Now it started folding. See that fin that comes out? It's decided to use any trick it has. Okay? At its disposal. I don't like saying this. Just don't read that. Yeah, you can read the forget the top. But just repeating what I said, you know, you can see a bunch of features that help you. Okay, so you can locally compress the sheet. By compress, I mean take it into some other dimension in any way you want. Okay. What's going to happen here? We're going to get folds. This is a fold that just runs from left to right. From 1 o'clock to the middle. Okay, I'm going to stop the movie. Otherwise, I won't get to the one point I wanted to tell you. Okay, but the point of the movie is, I'll tell you the point of the movie. Okay, so look, this is a succession of shapes you go through as you make the drop smaller and smaller. Okay? That's a 30 nanometer film, and I'm doing this kind of torture to it, and having it wrap around chocolate. Okay? See, it starts off axially symmetric. Then it starts making wrinkles, then it starts making crumples, then it starts making polygonal shapes with folds, and then finally it makes this packet over here, this samosa kind of thing. How do you begin to even understand this set of shapes? This is great, okay? This is great for the sheet. It can do anything it likes at very little cost. But we died understanding wrinkles in 2D in an axisymmetric problem. Folds we don't understand. Crumples we understand bits and pieces. All these elements interacting on a curved surface, what do we do with this? And you know, the big clue came from experiment. And this is the experiment that Joey did that helped. I showed you this for 29 nanometer film. He's done things from about this size all the way to maybe 400 nanometers. And you can see the pictures. They're all the same. OK, they're not all the same at some level. The wrinkle wavelength here is different from the wrinkle wavelength there. The fine details of how you handle compression, the microstructure, the stuff that we've been talking about the last 2 days are different for all these things. But it's trying to do the same thing. The gross shapes are all the same. Okay? And you change in this process the thickness of the sheet by a factor of 10. Changing the thickness of the sheet by a factor of 10 is changing bending modulus by 1,000. Okay, actually it's a little bit more than 10 we've done, but whatever. Huh? This means, possibly, all kinds of mechanics are unimportant. Okay? Right? If the elasticity of the sheet is not entering this problem, then, you know, nice. We don't have to worry about all the details, right? So this is the guess. I'm going to write an equation, Eric. Sorry, I will show it's a minimizing a free energy, but it's the only equation in understanding all of this. I have to take this sheet, and I have to minimize this equation. I have to say the only energy here at very high bendability, okay, is the cost of having a free surface over here. So I'm giving you a volume of drop, I'm giving you a size of sheet, and I say, drop, please do the best you can, drop and sheet, please do the best you can to minimize the exposed thing. And this produces actually very non-intuitively for us initially, not the Ferrero-Rocher shape. I thought you make this very thin, it's just going to conform to what the drop wants. But the drop wants to minimize, a sphere minimizes its total surface area. It only wants to minimize its exposed surface area, okay? Which is a different problem. And the nice thing is there are no material parameters in solving this. Even the value of the surface tension doesn't matter, okay? You got all this power because in the background, there is all these defects working for you. They have the ability to freely compress. So I've hidden the hard part of this problem, which is the constraint that says that material points can only approach each other. They can't stretch. But they can do that at no cost. You can compress at no cost. Okay? So this works when you get this big separation of scales. Stretching is very, very expensive. You don't want to stretch something that's 20 nanometers and millimeters in size. Surface energy costs are high. And you will see immediately, because now you are experts at all of this, that this ratio is exactly the bendability. Okay, so in high bendability, the first thing you do is solve the problem with all the radial forces and just forget about bending. Okay, and this is what the drop does, and I won't show you a solution. We understand lots of things about it. So in fact, the ones I showed you have a triangle at the end. You can do better than the triangle. You can do this shape, which again is, there's a reason that food gets wrapped in a certain way. It's with the least amount of crust, what can you do to fill in as much of good stuff in it as possible? And there are solutions. Sphere is just an okay solution. Empanada is a guji or whatever you whatever you call this is a very good solution. This is a not bad solution. Okay. Sorry. Yeah. You have a favorite kind of thing that you want to add? Yes. So this particular thing that I wanted to say is that a thin sheet really spontaneously achieves very high wrapping efficiency without design. Okay, you didn't have to cut in suitable places with an answer in mind. It has a way of disposing of extra material. In this regime, it doesn't, in high bendability, it doesn't care what the details of material parameters. So you can do things with this later. Finally, the thing is, the energy doesn't depend on the material at all. It doesn't depend on the thin sheet. It doesn't depend on elasticity. And it says, there's a clue that this is a clue that you can do things nearly isometrically for many, many situations if you're in this high bending limit. You can achieve solutions that depend only very, very weakly on the material property if you're suitably thin. And yet you get all the advantages of having a solid sheath. You have a barrier, you have a shear modulus, this thing doesn't like being sheared. If you put a patterns on it, the patterns will stay, right? It's not a liquid barrier. Okay, so just to come back to where we started, this was the plan. I think we spent the most time on something that's not over here, which is wrinkles in two dimensions. In some ways, my goal was to walk you through a whole bunch of literature from the last 10 or 12 years that addresses various pieces of these problems. And I hope I've got you to the point where you don't feel alarmed about tackling that. None of this is textbook stuff, unfortunately, yet. It's not settled in well enough. You can see there are huge holes in our knowledge. We didn't understand folds completely. We didn't understand wrinkle to fold in a deep way. We don't understand wrinkle to crumple in a deep way. So there's lots of big holes here. But that was sort of the goal, to get to the point where there's this body of stuff that I hope you can jump in and help with. Finally, I want to end with thanks to all of you folks for sitting and listening, but the school organizers, in particular the local folks. I organize a summer school, and I was telling Leo, some of you have come, I'm exhausted at the end of the week. I don't know how he does it for 4 weeks every year for 15 years, but one of his secrets is that he has extremely good lieutenants. But I also want to thank various people who have taught me. This is not an exhaustive list of collaborators, but this is a list of people whose ideas have found their way into what I was telling you, aside from the people who wrote the papers that I referenced. These three folks are former students. Joey Paulson is a nearly former postdoc. He leaves tomorrow for a faculty position at Syracuse. Tom Russell is a colleague in polymer science with whom I've collaborated for many years, who makes lovely materials and has lots to say about interfacial physics. Benny Davidovich and two postdocs of his in particular who have been very helpful in helping me learn. And these two other folks, Enrique Cerda and Dominic Vella. So I'll clean up today's notes. Today's notes will be a little bit more than I put on the board, unlike the last 2 days' notes. So I'll put the scaling arguments for these. So thanks a lot. We can have coffee, or you can ask me stuff, or whatever you like. Yeah.
So in the last example you were showing,
yeah,
you can expect a different bendability parameter. You can get shapes like a square or a hexagon.
Okay. I'm glad you bring me back to this. If you have very poor bendability, it'll make solutions that are only smooth. It'll make cylinders, things like that. If you have high bendability, depending on how much you want to cover, you can get in-between shapes, like square symmetry shapes, pentagon symmetry shapes, things like that, yeah.
So if you go too far, you can...
It depends on